Illinois faces some big challenges. Today, we're about to hear a truly honest analysis of the problems we face. Equally as important, you'll also hear an in-depth discussion of some practical solutions. This is your radio source for stories, the insight, and the answers you won't hear anywhere else. Not in the media, and not coming from Springfield. You're listening to Illinois Rising, presented by the Illinois Policy Institute. Now, here's your host, AM 560's Dan Proft.
Good afternoon, Dan Proft, and joining me on this edition of Illinois Rising is Illinois Policy Institute President and CEO John Tillman. John, we've had a bunch of big speeches in Springfield the last couple of weeks. We had Governor Rauner give his State of the State address. We had the President of the United States make a rare appearance.
A healing appearance. Let's all just get along and love one another.
Yeah, exactly. Following up, though, on something Rauner made mention of in his State of the State address, even President Obama agrees with me on redistricting reform and term limits. Now, I think maybe President Obama is a late convert to those positions, but a convert nonetheless. He made mention of redistricting reform specifically in his address this week. But now we look prospectively to Governor Rauner's budget address on this coming Wednesday, the 17th. What do you expect the governor to lay out as we're 8 months into this budget impasse?
I think he's going to lay out a broad structure, and I think he's going to of how to solve it for the current fiscal year with the current impasse that this fiscal year runs through June 30th. Then I think he's going to lay out a framework for how to get through the next fiscal year and try to combine the two. And I think he's going to ask for authority from the General Assembly to solve some of these problems through them authorizing him to make cuts and allocate resources with limited resources that we have. In other words, put him on the hot seat and take yourselves off. As to whether or not Speaker Madigan wants to do that or not is another question.
Well, somebody that has been on the front lines on the inside trying to fashion some points of compromise and get a budget deal done, she is Donna Ardwin, the former budget director for Governor Rauner, who now is a senior fellow at the Illinois Policy Institute. And she joins us now. Donna, thanks for joining us. Appreciate it.
Hi, glad to be here.
So I guess start with maybe your experience. Everybody's talking about it, but few people have really been on the inside trying to fashion a budget the way that you have. What was your experience during your time as the budget director and the real stumbling blocks that you found in terms of trying to make progress towards a constitutionally balanced budget?
I would start with, and compared to other states that I have worked in, Illinois oddly requires the governor to put together and give to the legislature this time every year a detailed, balanced budget plan. And we worked very, very hard on putting together a plan that not only balanced the budget, but did it with the lower tax rates that we have in place right now. And but unlike other states, the legislature has no real requirement to do anything. So we are sitting here a year later, and the budget office is getting ready to put together a budget for the fiscal year that starts in July, and the legislature hasn't acted on the one the governor gave them last year. So, you know, the experience working with the governor's office and agencies and putting together a well-crafted plan, you know, was fantastic given all the difficulties that Illinois faces. But the experience of watching for a year now, waiting for the legislature to act, has been very frustrating.
Donna, you're perhaps the foremost expert in the country on state budgets. You worked for 5 years for Jeb Bush, who by all accounts was a fiscal conservative and had many good accomplishments. And to be clear, that's not an endorsement of his presidential ambitions, but he did a great job in this respect as governor of Florida. You worked for George Pataki, you worked for John Engler, you worked for the a former governor of California, Arnold Schwarzenegger, during, as you like to say, his one good year. What's been the most shocking about Illinois versus all these other places where you've had such interesting experiences as well?
Believe it or not, there actually were more than one shocking thing.
Surprise, surprise.
Surprise, surprise. I mean, even compared to California and New York, which certainly have their challenges, but compared to, you know, well-run states that have fiscally conservative constitutions and law structures like Florida and even Michigan, there were a lot of surprises. First, I've been in, obviously, been in states that have, you know, union control of many items surrounding the budget, but none like I saw in Illinois. The union control is just really sort of intertwined and choked off many aspects of the governor and even legislature's ability to control the fiscal situation here. The other thing that surprised me really was the demoralization of the government. You know, they can't hire staff. They're doing things in a way that's just far more expensive than they would do if they were, you know, given some flexibility on how to manage. The state buildings are falling apart, and it's all because the legislature just hasn't been able or willing to deal with the cost of pensions in Illinois, the cost of state employees through the collective bargaining system, which is just has far more control than it does in other states to drive wages, salaries, health insurance, and pensions up. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with paying people who work for government a good wage, but it is a problem when it becomes both a detriment to government's ability to operate or even be able to employ people, and also to the detriment of taxpayers who just can't afford not only to pay for those things for state employees, but to pay for them for themselves. They don't have those types of wage hikes and health insurance, and certainly not the kind of pensions that state employees have been promised.
I was doing a little research for a piece on this topic, generally speaking, and I came across a story. I'll just read you the lead graph. Confounded over how to close a gaping budget hole, Democrats who control Illinois government agreed on a two-year plan to divert hundreds of millions of dollars earmarked to underfunded state pension plans and use it for schools and other programs. That's from a Chicago Tribune article in 2005. And it has been this rinse and repeat approach to state government for decades, for generations. But here's the problem, and I wonder what your perspective is on it. When you have social service providers not getting paid for work performed and state vendors not getting paid for work performed or services provided, you can understand their hue and cry. Just do something. Why not just pass the budget, the $4 billion unbalanced budget that Madigan and Cullerton want you to pass? I mean, we've been doing unconstitutionally unbalanced budgets for 14 years. Let's just keep it going because I need to get paid to keep my doors open. So on the one hand, you're sympathetic to people who are being scammed by a government they've provided goods or services to. And on the other hand, and they're used to just what this Tribune article from 10 years ago reported and what has been going on for 15 years. So let's just do this for now, and we can just figure it out next year.
Oh, good question. And I don't think anybody went into this, you know, wanting to have vendors not getting paid. But if this doesn't stop, as you were saying, we're going to come to a crisis. You know, the state and the pension system will run out of cash, and then nobody will get paid. And, you know, it'll be worse than that. There'll be no one getting paid, and we won't have services. So the governor, you know, didn't do this so that vendors couldn't get paid. He did this so that we could bring about real change in Illinois and stop the slide, turn the slide around, which is why he calls his agenda the turnaround agenda.
And do you get the sense, and John, too, as well, I'll throw this up to you, do you get the sense that until something like that happens, I mean, this is what you're describing as the responsible thing to do, of course, and it's funny because it doesn't seem like state workers and others get the idea that this is the position that's actually in their interest, like you kind of you're on their side and they're not. But the idea that until and unless something cataclysmic like that happened, a whole host of state legislators and a whole lot of public sector union bosses just don't believe it will ever come to that.
Go ahead, Donna. Yeah, I think that is absolutely true. I think, and Donna, maybe you can address their delusion by talking a little bit about the tax burden in Illinois. I think one of the things that is so ironic when I talk to union spokespeople is they don't think the people of Illinois are taxed enough. They think much more money needs to come out of individual taxpayers' wallets and be put into their wallets, which is how they get paid. And they don't take the evidence of the out-migration, people abandoning ship and going to other states, not just Florida and Texas, but we lose population to every single other Midwest state, every single one of our neighboring states, of course. And, Don, you've done a lot of work and seen tax burdens and the spending burden that states take on, whether it's state taxes and spending or local taxes and spending, including property taxes. And this is a very big indicator of future success, is it not?
It is. It is, John, and you hit on the most important issue. You know, we can argue the numbers anyway, you know, several ways. But the fact of the matter is people get to choose in this day and age where they want to live, where they want to run their businesses, where they want to invest and provide jobs, and they're leaving Illinois. And that's just irrefutable. So when you look at migration amongst people who are citizens of the United States, people are leaving Illinois more than they're leaving other states. And to your point, John, the tax burden that any state faces is really the amount that's being spent. The amount of money governments are spending, including for pension systems, even if they're really committing that spending to the future by taking out debt, not making payments, it all counts, and the economy feels it. So if the legislature says, well, we're only spending this amount because we're just going to push off pension payments, the economy feels the full burden of that. And that's the reason why we see the results that we do, which is that people are leaving Illinois.
Don Arduin, former Governor Rauner budget director, now a senior fellow at the Illinois Policy Institute. Donna, thanks so much for joining us. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Dan.